Good time. Good morning, everybody. I'm really happy to be here. This is one of my favorite rooms, and you know, we've been coming here for some years now, and having fun, having great workshops. It's good to see, as Mary Ann said, a lot of familiar faces from Fall River Street Tree Planting Program in the city, and some new folks. And so what I want to do today, this morning, is sort of have a conversation. I'm going to maybe challenge some ideas, maybe throw some new species of trees out there, talk a little bit about diversification. And some of the concepts I want to talk about are monotypic species, species where there's only one, you know, where there's only one tree in a genus. And that has to do with a few things like pests. There are very few pests and diseases who would want to attack that genus that only has one species. So that's one of the concepts we'll talk a little bit about. Microclimate and urban heat island effect and how they relate as far as diversification. Assisted migration. So when we help trees move, so we'll talk a little bit about some southern species and maybe taking hardy, cold hardy cultivars of those southern species and moving them north into warm microclimates as a way to diversify. And maybe a few other things. But so I want to encourage you to interrupt me all the time. You know, if you've got a question or you want to talk a little bit more about something, we've got enough time in here and I can eat into Chance's time. He doesn't, no, just
kidding, Chance.
Thank you. Yeah. So so we'll have some fun and we'll talk about some fun things. And I'm going to throw some trees up there, and there's no one tree, there's no one tree list. You know what I mean? We need to think more about all these species and think about where we might put them. You know, are they invasive? You know, when we move things, we take a risk of unleashing something, and a few other things. So diversify now is the name. And one thing, when you look at this picture of Fall River, this aerial photo is, you know, stands out is the water everywhere. And that has a moderating effect on the climate. So the new hardiness zones, if you've seen, you know, the USDA has put out new hardiness maps, and just about everything has moved a half a zone warmer. And that's not all due to climate change or anything. A lot of it has to do with better readings, taking into effect bodies of water, a longer period of time of taking measurements. So there's a number of reasons why that is the case, but we know that hardiness zones have become a little bit warmer since 2012. This the new map was produced in 2012. The previous map showed everything about a half a zone colder. This is southern magnolia, one of my favorite trees. I encourage you all to think about planting this tree. This is the, you know, the tree of the south. I'm going to talk about a couple species. One is the state tree of Mississippi, southern magnolia. Another is the state tree of Louisiana. Anybody know what that one is? I'm sure you probably planted some around. Bald cypress. I encourage you to think about planting bald cypresses. And a third tree that we'll talk about is the state tree of the Lone Star State, the great state of Texas. Anybody know what that one is? This is a tough one. It's pecan. They wouldn't think of that, but pecan is the state tree of Texas. I encourage you all to think about planting all of those, state tree of Texas, Louisiana, Mississippi, here in Fall River. Oh, and let me go back. I'll probably move around a little bit. So if you can see, is there a laser on here?
There isn't, unfortunately, but I'm curious to see how you're going to use it as your remote.
Oh, it'll work. And you can do this too. So if you look up in the upper right-hand corner, that's asphalt. That's a street. And that's a street tree in the city of Ithaca that I planted about 15, 20 years ago, something like that. Sort of a climate change joke I was doing, but it was an expensive one. And I planted 20 of these southern magnolias and most of them are still alive. Some had to be taken down because of construction, but, you know, I wanted to go into town after Stella. We just got maybe a foot and a half, 2 feet of snow in our county, depending on where you were. In my house, I got drifts that were 4 feet deep. But I wanted to go in and take some pictures of these southern magnolias with their big broad, it's a broadleaf evergreen, covered with snow, and they're fine. So this is a variety called Edith Bogue, and it's one of the most cold-hardy southern magnolias. Another one that is really cold-hardy is Bracken's Brown Beauty. So a couple southern magnolias that you can certainly plant here. They're tolerant of saline soils. They're tolerant of salt spray, so we can put them near the water. Massachusetts, so this is the new, relatively new, hardiness zone map. And you can see, actually I can put the cursor up there right now. So you can see where we are here is, what is that, 7A? We're at 7A. Is that right, Mollie? 7A. A lot of the state is, you know, up in the Berkshires, you've got 5A, so this is a quite a range. In New York, we've got the Adirondacks, where there's like tundra up in the high peak region, all the way down to 7B on Long Island. But there's quite a range of zones in Massachusetts, and out on the Cape, I think there's a little bit of 7B, which is the banana belt. I think that's it, 7B. B stands for banana. So think about that. We're obviously in a nice little warm spot down here. And so we'll talk a little bit about microclimates. And gardeners like Mary Ann and the garden club you belong to, they know that there's warm places in your yard, sunny spots. In the cities, we have thermal pollution, which can be used to our advantage. And this is a case of thermal pollution and making a little tropical garden, that's a joke. But, you know, gardeners have long known that there's places where you can put something that's a little tender and get away with it. I've known my hometown up on Lake Ontario, I knew some guys who planted figs, and every winter they would bend them down and mulch them over and cover them, and then, you know, that's a pretty cold place up there. Yeah, microclimates. This is a Acer saccharum, sugar maple, Seneca Chief. And I planted that at an Arbor Day in a little park down the road from me. It's actually a little tiny park, about 17 acres. It's owned by our neighbors. All the neighbors own it. We all mow it, take care of it. There's a pond, there's a pavilion. And on an Arbor Day, we planted these Seneca Chiefs. One is on one side of this little dirt drive, gravel driveway. The other is just 30 feet away on the other side. I took these pictures the same day. And the other one is in a little bit different. It's a microclimate. It's a little bit warmer. I mean, these trees are exactly the same. They're genetically identical. They're clones. And so the variation between the two that I saw last fall was pretty cool. I thought, this one gets a little more sun. You know, it's maybe a little bit better drained. There's a ditch on the other side of it that goes down quite a ways. It's just a slightly different spot, and the trees look slightly different certain days of the year. And this, so hardy pecan, this is the state tree of what? Texas! The great state of Texas. So this is in my backyard. I'm up in a little bit colder part of the county than Ithaca. But this is a hardy pecan from Michigan. So it's doing fine there. I've got a few more. You have to plant a few to have fruit. So so far I haven't had any harvest of pecans, but I expect to. And I think this is a great tree for people to think about growing. You know, I love pecans, and we can grow them here. There's another shot of it. You can kind of see I live out in the, it's all fields and forest and swamps. I live on a road called Swamp College Road. But this pecan tree has nice fall color, yellow fall color, and obviously it's been there quite a while. It was just a
a ruby cutting, woody cutting when I planted it, probably cost me like $8. And now I've got a few beautiful pecan trees in my backyard. I got it from Oikos Nursery in Kalamazoo, and those folks are crazy. They hybridize all kinds of oaks. If you want a Burr English, you know, they've got it. If you, you know, they just cross all kinds of oak trees, and it's a really cool nursery. I'm pretty sure it's still in business. This variety was something they found called Dawson Creek, and I think there was a flood, and there's no more Dawson Creek available to them. All the trees got wiped out in a big flood out there in Michigan. Bald cypress, the state tree of Louisiana. We always think about these down south in Florida, covered with Spanish moss. I've planted a lot of these. A friend of mine is a city forester in Lansing, Michigan, and that was the first time I ever saw him as a street tree. I was up there in the wintertime about 20 years ago, and he was showing me all these bald cypresses at, you know, between the sidewalk and the curb. And I thought, wow, that's so cool. So we planted some this is a park in Ithaca, very obviously a wet swale it's right next to a skate park. And which you can see in the background, but this wet sort of a ditch runs along there, and we put a whole bunch of bald cypresses in there. And today they're putting up knees, which the lawnmower guys don't like, but I just tell them stay away. And they're growing like crazy. Anybody plant bald cypress? Yeah, whereabouts?
Worcester.
Worcester?
In Worcester, yeah.
Not an ALB host.
Right.
So. We got to look around for trees that are not Asian longhorn beetle hosts, and you know, this is one of them. Very few pests at all, really. Very few diseases affect them. They're, you know, they have needles sometimes during the year. They're pretty bare, right? But it's a cool tree, and you can limb them up. These are kept limb low, which I always like to do if we don't have a reason to limb them up. But I've seen them as street trees where they were limbed up quite high, and the trunks are beautiful. Remind me a lot of Dawn Redwood trunks. Battery out?
And did you have a nursery?
There's a power button on the back. It wasn't being used.
What was the question?
Do you have a nursery that you find those?
Yeah, I'm trying to remember where I got them. It might have been Schichtel's in Western New York. Some of the southern species, I get them from Moon Nursery in Maryland. That's where I got those Edith Bogue southern magnolias. So for some of these southern species, you have to go a little ways south to find them. And that's another thing I want to talk about is we need to drive the industry. So if we want to plant new trees or diversify, we've got to get growers to start growing them. And then there's going to be a 4 or 5 year lag, right, before we can actually buy them. As consumers and tree planters, we need to tell the industry what we want, and I think that's changing. We don't need any more varieties of red maple, I don't think. There's a lot of them, you know, there's literally hundreds of cultivars of red maple. Great tree, salt tolerant, you know, and tough tree, overplanted in a lot of cases, but, you know, maybe they should start thinking about planting a few rows of something different. And this is what we were talking about earlier before the meeting this morning. Calopanax septemolimpus, which I'm sure you all know is the previous name, Calopanax pictus. Right? No. So this is a pretty unknown tree, and I just heard from Mollie that it might be invasive, and sure enough, I looked it up, and there's some concern, the Forest Service is a little concerned about it, and it's been found in New Hampshire. So it's an unusual tree. You're gonna have a hard time finding it. You can get seeds and cuttings easy all over the internet. Finding trees that are already street tree size would be a little tougher. If we want to grow these, plant them, we're going to have to demand that they grow them in the nurseries.
Does it have a common name?
Castor aurelia. Castor aurelia, Calopanax. Formerly Calopanax pictus, and the taxonomists, you know, changed the names just to you know, just to make it trouble for us. And you can see it's armed. You know, it's a juvenile thing. They're thorny, which they lose as the tree gets bigger. You'll see a mature trunk will have no thorns on it. And a beautiful shape. But this is the only species in the genus. It's not only that, it's the only species in the family. And basically, it's, I don't know of any insect pests, any diseases. It's a wide, it'll tolerate a wide range of pH. It's a tough, tough tree with very few pests. And maybe something we might want to consider. If it's invasive, and you know, a lot of trees are, we have to think about where does it invade. If we plant it downtown in a heavily built urban environment, you know, where's it going to go? Is it spread by birds? So there's a lot of things we need to think about before we unleash something like this. But I just want us to start thinking about other species, because diversity in ecology equals stability. You know, the more diverse our urban forest is, the less likely we're going to get wiped out by a single pest. And
what's that?
The fruit is, they're little purple berries. Mm-hmm. So they have white flowers that hang down. I don't know if I've got any photos. Disease resistant, insect resistant, pH adaptable. We can show you. I'll show you some pictures of the fruit after at break time if you like. But nice fall color. You can see the mature shape. Winter outline is coarse. Outline, but the thorns will be gone on the trunk. So they're pretty armored when they're juvenile, which is not a bad thing all the time. Here we go, back to Edith Bogue. So that's this is one of my favorites. I love southern magnolias. Well, after I planted these, you know, they have dinner plate size blooms and they smell great. It's, you know, Michael Durr says that it smells better than any perfume. And I would get calls as soon as they start blooming. Yeah, Chance.
Have you had problems with frost cracking on them?
No, I haven't seen any problems with frost cracking. That's a good question. These are multi-stem and branch low for the most part still, so they're protected a little bit. And they're evergreen, so they're shade, you know, we're not getting the sun hitting them on the south side and causing that.
You use this as a street tree?
Yeah.
What about droppings?
You know, People would ask me when I was city forester, is this tree going to be messy? They'd ask me about every tree. Is this tree going to be messy? My answer was always, yeah. You know, trees are messy. It's a messy world out there. God made all trees messy. They're shedding organisms, right? They're great energy storing organisms, but they're also shedding organisms. They shed leaves, twigs, bark, branches. You know, they just, so I would, yeah, these are messy trees. And so are almost every other tree I planted.
Yeah, of course, aren't. But
yeah. So they, you know, they. So you'll see, like, the, you know, the, and they don't decompose. You know, those leathery evergreen leaves. They hang around.
That's awesome. I'm like, I love it, but like, man, I would get, chased down the street with a pitchfork. You know, if I told the truth, I don't know.
Yeah, I should show you some of my scars.
Nice.
So that's the fruit. What do I do? Keep turning this off?
If you don't use it for a while, it's fine. Okay. If you don't use it for a while, it kind of goes into the auto.
So in this neighborhood, nice wide tree lawn, and it hasn't been limbed up. But this is a few years ago, in the winter, obviously. Tree's doing great, looks great. It's nice to have evergreen trees in the winter in the city, too.
Any shade tolerance to that?
Shade, they like sun. They're moderately shade tolerant, though. They're tolerant of saline soils. There's hardly any pests that bother them. And they're tolerant of salt spray. So if you're near the coast, that's not a problem for them.
Preferred soil moisture is?
And, you know, we get a lot of rain in Ithaca. But they will tolerate some dry conditions as well.
They got a really wet spot that I'd love to put something.
Yeah, what is wet spots? I would go with pond cypress or bald cypress and Nyssa sylvatica, but also, which I know is one of Mary Ann's favorite trees, but what about Nyssa aquatica? that's water tupelo. Anybody ever see the great Peter Fonda movie, Yuli's Gold? So he was a beekeeper. Anyway, he would take all his hives out into these tupelo swamps, make tupelo honey, which is, you know, the best, you know, it's expensive stuff. And that's Nyssa aquatica. So, so anyway, you could see those trees on that street had been limbed up a little bit more, a little bit more street tree. But these were multi-stems. And, you know, we can get them as a single stem, or those trees could have been thinned out a little bit, trained to have a single stem. This is another great tree that's hardy here, hardly ever planted. They are really uniform. If you see them in a nursery, look down the row, they look like clones. They're not, they're oaks, and it's hard to clone them. Nina Bassick's been working for years on some stuff that's going to be published pretty soon about propagating oaks. But Quercus lyrata, or overcup oak, anybody familiar with this one? This is the oak that will tolerate flooding. Inundation is not a problem for it. It can be flooded for weeks and it'll be fine. So they grow often in sloughs or wet areas along rivers and stuff in the south, but they're hardy for here, and it's overcup, and we'll show you why. Well, this is after Sandy, there was a lot of replanting done in the Rockaways, which got hit really hard, you know, the in Long Island, outside New York City. So the New York City Parks planted a whole bunch of these in the Rockaways where it's prone to flooding. So we'll keep an eye on them. They had to go south to get them. I think they went to a nursery in North Carolina to get them. But I don't think it's going to be a hardiness problem for them. That's from Google Streets, nothing like it. I took this picture last fall, the end of the summer. That's why they're called overcup oak. They're almost totally enclosed, and a really interesting looking fruit. The leaves are clean. It's just a great tree, and for a wet area, and they're perfect. It can be flooded and wet. Saturated soils broke. And like a lot of trees that tolerate flooding, they'll also tolerate droughts, drowning conditions. So like swamp white oak is tolerant. What's my time again?
You have till 12:10, and it's 11:45.
12 what?
You have until
12:10.
Okay, cool. So you can interrupt me and ask questions a lot then, because we're almost done. So another one, Meshoii. This is in Ithaca again. I like to say I planted it, but the new city forester there, Gene Grace, planted this. Ithaca is real fortunate, and I was real fortunate when I was there to have Dr. Nina Bassick as the chair of the Shade Tree Committee. So she's all about diversity and trying new stuff. I really like swamp chestnut oak a lot. It's anything that begins with swamp, going to tolerate some wet soils. Again, though, it's also tolerant of dry soils and droughting conditions, I mean.
These two oaks, what are their native ranges?
Their native ranges are up to the center of the Mid-Atlantic, but they're definitely hardy here in Fall River. They're in Ithaca, which downtown Ithaca, the bowl is warmer, maybe might be a 6A, so, you know, it's not quite as warm as it is here. So they'll do fine there.
Would you recommend trees like that outside their native range over locally native?
What I recommend is that we think about moving assisted migration.
Yeah.
So we're already seeing migration. Mangroves are going up the Florida coast. They're moving north, and that's a tree that will tolerate saltwater flooding, which we have pretty much nothing that'll tolerate saltwater flooding for any length of time. But when we start planting mangroves, we're gonna be in a lot of trouble. So I recommend them because, you know, they're great oaks, you know, they not particularly invasive. There's not a lot of problems with planting new varieties of oaks generally. And And they, we're moving towards, you know, conditions that these trees really, really like. Especially with, and it's microclimates, urban heat island, and what used to be global warming. I don't know if we don't have to worry about that anymore, I'm afraid. I'm sorry. We'll make any more political jokes, but there's been some interesting stuff about global warming lately. Swamp white oak. This is out in my out by my barn, and I have a lot of beekeepers around me. So this swarm came in, and I don't know if you've ever anybody have ever played with a swarm of honeybees. You know, they're very docile. When they're like this, they will not sting you. So I called my neighbor, and she drove her pickup truck across that big field that you saw on the previous slide, parked underneath it with a super. And I went up and just snipped it off with my Felco pruners, you know, and dropped it. And she took them back, and they're fine. They probably, a queen probably left one of her colonies and was out here, and they were happy to get it back. So I've got some nice basswood honey out of the deal. Soon we'll have tupelo honey. So anyway, swamp white oak, another great tree, begins with the word swamp, and it's drought tolerant too. I've planted a lot of these. I can't kill them. I've planted them bare root, bald and burlap, spring, fall. It seems to make no difference. I have 100% survival rate. Unless they get run over by a car, they're going to make it, in my experience. Now, sweet gum, you know, I'm sure people plant sweet gum, right? It's not that big of a deal, not that unusual. But, you know, it, for a while, there, it didn't do well in Ithaca, and certainly not a little bit further north. But there are hardy cultivars. This is moraine, which, you know, it's kind of glacial, has a glacial connotation, moraine. And so it's a very cold, hardy variety. And I planted that. They did this, put this tour together after I was gone. They probably didn't know what the cultivar was, so I could have told them if they'd asked. So that's a little clump of sweet gums that I planted at the entrance to a park, and beautiful fall color, nice tree. So we'll talk a little bit about monotypic species, and here's a few of them. There's of these trees, there's only one species in the genus. And why is that important? It's, you know, if I was a pest, I'm not going to want to have a host that's only, where there's only one species in the genus. Mind your way.
Don't worry.
I'll go with Mary Ann's way. So some of these are, I love, like Parodia persica, Persian Parodia, definitely one of my favorite trees. Another fall color. These, between sweet gum and Persian Parodia, they rival sugar maple in fall color. Maclura palmifera, that's Osage orange. Fantastic tree, really drought tolerant. There's a cultivar called White Shield. I think it's White Shield. It's a really nice variety, and I think that's a Schmitz introduction, Schmitz nursery. That's a tree we should probably have in our inventory. There's a few in Ithaca that they produce fruit up on the hills. I mean, Ithaca is like surrounded by hills, so there's a few of them up on these hills. The fruit falls down, and it looks like a round brain-looking thing, and they roll down the hill, and then people find them and they look around and think, where the heck did this come from? You know, what tree produces this thing? So. Eucomia omoides, that's a hardy rubber tree, another great tree. It doesn't have fall color. I mean, it just like drops the leaves when they're just pale green. But it's tough, there's no pests, and it's fun to, it's got latex in it. So, you know, I'd show the kids, well, you can pull a leaf apart and then the latex strands will hold the leaf together. And then you gotta watch out because they'll pull all the leaves off. Succinophyllum japonicum, again, that's Katsura, might be a little invasive. Oh no, this is a abeho species, yeah. So we have to think about that. And Calpanax again.
This is a Persian Peronia. Look at the size of that. This is in Casina Park in New York City, in Queens. Yeah, I think so. But it's in a park that was the nursery that Olmsted used to supply trees for Central Park and then for his masterpiece, Prospect Park, which a lot of people don't realize. Central Park was his practice run. Prospect Park, he also designed and learned a lot from first job there. So look at the bark is fantastic, the fall color is great, and you can see these trees can get quite large. But these are left over from the nursery, so there's rows of trees in there, just really neat trees. And that's Jim Ketchell from New York City Parks, and he's doing a cultural landscape report on that Casino Park, which was a nursery.
What did you say that was?
That's Persian Peronia.
Oh, that's big.
Yeah, bro, is that big? Yeah, isn't that cool? I mean, I've never seen one that big. I was just flabbergasted. And I could have spent the whole day there. A couple of my bosses in the picture, and a few other friends. In the same park, there's a row of Cercidophyllum. So these trees were lined out in rows. They seem to be a little close together, but I think they clump also. They'll do that naturally. But again, look at the size of those katsuras. And if you've ever been underneath a big katsura in the fall, that cotton candy smell is just fantastic. I see a few people shaking their heads. You know what I'm talking about. Great tree. Just for that reason alone, I would like to have them around. So Cercidophyllum japonicum, katsura, Asian longhorn beetles. But hopefully that pest is going to be completely eradicated. We still have hope that this is what's going to happen. So 99, the guy at your left is Eric Woodward, who's a tree trimmer for me. Woodward is an old English name, warden of the woods. So he comes from many generations of arborists, and he was he's in a lot of the videos we produce, and the Cornell students call him Cigar Smoking Man, kind of X-Files thing, you know. You always had to have a cigar. In every video you'll see smoking a cigar, running the chainsaw. And I look like the tree planter here, but those two guys are really, they're like human backhoes. Those guys really are the tree planters. But you can see in the background, this is downtown Ithaca on the Commons. It's one of the last pedestrian malls left in New York State from the 70s. It's a warm microclimate. There's all kinds of thermal pollution. So I don't know if you can see what it's in the background, like behind my head there. Anybody know what that is? Bananas. Banana trees. Can you believe that? A few years later, I'm just kidding. People in Ithaca will plant a banana tree early in the spring and grow them all season. Then, of course, they die. But so some of the things we talked about, bald cypress, but Taxodium ascendens, that's pond cypress. Another very closely related, very similar, but different species. So a lot of landscape architects, they'll put Taxodium disticum with Nyssa sylvatica. Well, maybe we ought to think about putting Taxodium ascendens with this aquatica, just to mix things up a little bit. Atlas cedar, another great tree to consider. The hybrid live oaks, the Compton oaks, I didn't get into this much, but there are Compton oaks in New York City. This is a sort of a live oak. Crape myrtle, the crabapple of the South. There are hardy varieties of these. If you go down and see how they prune them, they up and head them over. We call that crepe murder.
Yeah.
Sweet gum, talked about that. So I forgot, that's the other concept I want to chat about is phenotypic plasticity. And it's where species can actually adapt to changing environmental conditions. And some species exhibit more phenotypic plasticity than others. And Quercus bicolor, swamp white oak, is one that has a lot of phenotypic plasticity. You put plant, take one from nursery, where it's nice and cool and moist, and you plant that tree in a hot
dry place, it'll change. The leaves get thinner, the stomata change, it'll adapt to that, to those changed conditions. And so this, one of the reasons why this tree can adapt to both drought conditions and obviously swamp, white oak, wet conditions is its phenotypic plasticity. So some species exhibit a lot more of that than others. There's a great, this afterburner, do you know this one, Marianne?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you have some favorite cultivars of Nissa, right?
I love Nissa.
Yeah, yeah, so this afterburner is really sweet. Quiet fall color is fantastic. And then Aquatica again, we have to think about that. Bracken's Brown Beauty, that should be another quote at the end of Beauty. Sorry about that. But so those are the two really hardy cultivars, cultivated varieties. And pecan, those two oaks that we talked about, swamp chestnut oak and boulder cup oak. So this is when Mary Ann first started planting trees. This is the Studebaker water wagon. I think it's still over at the DPW yard, I'm not sure. So we're gonna have the combined effects of climate change and urban heat islands, and we consider that when we start thinking about what species we're going to be planting in those areas. This is a great presentation. If you can Google tree selection, changing climate, I'm sure you'll get to it. There's an article in ISA Arborist News from October of last year, selecting trees in a changing climate. Highly recommend, a great piece, great article about some of the stuff we've been talking about this morning. And any other questions or discussion or anything that you want to talk about?
I have a yellow poplar.
Why not? What do you think about it?
From the ones that I've seen planted since the 70s, they seem pretty hardy, and they don't seem to be attacked by insects. And they have good form and they're fast growing.
So you think it's street tree?
I haven't seen street tree planting. I've seen landscape.
Landscape, like parks and estates and yards and stuff, things like that. ALB host, right?
So Worcester is planting them as street trees.
Worcester is?
They're enormous.
Really?
Grow fast.
Yellow poplar.
Yeah.
And in Worcester, I've got to go take a look at it.
They're pretty trees.
Yeah. Well, anybody else have experience with yellow poplar yet? Got some here?
I've seen them, they get really big.
So yeah.
Like a street tree, you're usually concerned about the size of you. If you drop a lot of wood, they're very nice. That's nice, pretty.
Cool.
Does the wood tend to be brittle? Brittle, yeah. It grows so fast.
Huh. Yeah, yeah. So we definitely, you know, want to keep that in mind, keep it in the mix, maybe. Yeah.
So my question, Andy, phenotypic plasticity, are there some species that will adapt in the same season quickly to conditions that are hostile?
I think when they're really young in these experimental conditions, yes. You know, I don't pretend to be an expert on phenotypic plasticity. I just learned the word this morning. I don't know how long it takes, but I think it might be within a season. You know, they're going to know that they're in a different condition pretty fast and start changing. And I'm assuming that some species that exhibit phenotypic plasticity respond faster than others. I think swamp white oak might be one of those.
So generally, do you think those would be more of the type that have a lot of dynamic mass or capability, simplex, like Psycho called?
Yeah. There's within the species, you mean? Mm-hmm. Across the board, yeah. And so I think that's the case. I think that they just evolved to be adaptable for both hot, dry, and swampy, more humid conditions, and they can adapt. They're not evolving; they just adapt, when they're put in those conditions. And it's more with plants than animals, you know, for obvious reasons. Animals can move faster than plants, or, you know, have to stay put. So they have to adapt to changing conditions more than, you know, animals who could possibly migrate.
Are there any trees that we should definitely avoid planting?
Wow. That's a tough question.
In light because, of climate change.
Good question.
For climate change, you know, Mary Ann, nothing I can really think of. What? Anybody got any ideas about that? Like, what should we, you know, obviously where there's invasive pests, we want to be real careful. Like, I just recommended that the Cemetery of the Evergreens in Queens, it straddles Brooklyn and Queens, and oak wilt was found recently in Queens, in both in Prospect Park and in Greenwood Cemetery, big, beautiful old cemetery. That's pretty scary. It's also been found in Canandaigua and the Finger Lakes near where I live, and also in the Capital District near Albany. So oak wilt is not far from y'all, and it will kill in a season. Tin oaks, or, you know, any red oaks, but there's a couple that are real susceptible, and pin oak is definitely one of them, and other species in the red oak group. White oaks are a little bit more tolerant, but it'll kill them as well. And there are a few oaks, though, that are highly highly resistant to oak wilt. Monterey oak, bur oak, and another one, I'll think of it. It's another white oak, though, and one that we plant. So bur oak is another great oak tree to consider planting, especially on dry, you know, drier spots. And they get huge. They have acorns. Is it messy? It has golf ball size acorns. So yeah, that's a messy tree. So back to your question, I recommended that they don't plant, they hold off on planting any species of red oaks. And if they want to go in, there's another community nearby where they have anthracnose, and sycamore anthracnose. They also have emerald ash borer there. And they also have oak wilt nearby. And what's the disease, the soil-borne disease that affects maples and wilt?
Verticillium.
Verticillium, thanks. I wasn't getting it. Verticillium wilt. So whenever there was a tree that died, a maple that died of verticillium wilt in Ithaca, I would go back in with an oak tree in that site. And so what I recommended to them was, you know, in areas where you've got verticillium wilt, those planting sites, and you might lose a tree, think about planting an oak in there, but don't plant any red oaks. Think about planting a bur oak or another white oak.
Yeah.
So it's all, everything's so situational, right? And micro, you know, microclimate. We need to, there's no broad brush, there's no one good tree. There's not even a good list of 10 trees that we should think about that. You know, we've got to think about a lot of things. And cultivars, hardy cultivars from the south, assisting migration to a microclimate in the north, stuff like that.
Cultivars that we can use up here?
Oh yeah, I wouldn't.
No, I mean, so you're right about the red oaks dying, they're dying everywhere. Okay.
And yeah. Don't have oak wilt here yet, though.
No, but we have our malaria. And with the drought conditions, that's just spreading like crazy. So in Fall River, I don't know what it's like in New Bedford, but in Fall River, the red oaks are...
Yeah,
they're all struggling?
Yeah, that, and of course, when you know, elevate seem off on top of that,
yeah,
you know, I'm
yeah.
getting cold left and right, or... Yeah. Like, you're using it.
So do you know something that we can plant? Because that's our native tree. That
yeah.
Feeds
the
squirrels.
Boy. If... You know, I think we need to look at the white oaks, especially if we think there's going to be oak wilt. But it would be a shame if we can't plant scarlet oaks, you know, for that fantastic fall color. I've never been a fan of pin oaks, but that's because where I live, the soils are, the pH is so high that they're, every single one of them is chlorotic. And I've seen people plant them, you know, downtown where they're in concrete, and every single one of them, we call them sunburst. Pin oaks, that's a little geeky tree joke, right? the sunburst honey locusts have yellow leaves, right? The sunburst pin oaks have yellow leaves. So I don't know. It's a good question. But for the time being, I would think about sticking with some white oaks and some of the ones that are tolerant, more drought tolerant, which strangely or ironically begin with swamp. Mm. That's a tree that I planted in Stew structural soil extensively because we have limestone as our stone base there. We're not fortunate. Places in New England, you can get granite in structural soils, which are, you know, more pH neutral, and you can plant a much more wider palette than I can. So if I want to plant an oak in structural soils that's limestone based, I usually go with a chinquapin. Purchased really very good. Love that tree. Again, it's just a hardy, tough tree for sidewalks, downtowns, and it'll get big. That's the whole thing. I spent most of my career trying to figure out how we can get great big mature trees in the heavily built up downtown urban environments where you've got building facade, sidewalk, concrete sidewalk, asphalt street, same thing on the other side. How do we get trees there? We have to engineer and plan for them if we're talking to engineers. We have to plan for them and engineer for them if we're talking to planners. So we try to keep them out of the same room. Well, thanks a lot.